Burger. Today he would be dealing a very serious topic, starting from the mean, standard deviations, and other descriptive statistics he will be touch upon, and then he will switch over to statistical inference, probability distributions, and then some theories relating to sampling. So I would like to invite sir to deliver his session. Welcome, sir. This basically covers the block one and block two, a part of block one and the block two.
I'll teach you first what is statistics, some your mean, median, mode, all these things. Then we'll go to the probability distribution. So statistics, jota odia re koa je parishankhana, we mean aggregate of facts numerically expressed. This is two things I am telling: aggregate of facts and numerically expressed. Others are there. It affected by a multiplicity of causes. I am not going to that. So it is aggregate of facts and numerically expressed. These two things are more important. So statistics is nowadays used in many fields, not only in economics, but also in biology, also in psychology, also in education, also in some extent in political science, all these things. So application of statistics is now very wide. So it gives the method of comparison of data. We collect the data. We have two types of data. One is primary data, the other is secondary data. So data is a plural concept. It is singular is datum, and this data means a plural object. So primary data means original data, data which is collected by the enumerator by different methods, maybe by questionnaires or maybe by door-to-door inquiry, all these things. And secondary data is derived from this primary data. The data has already been utilized and then published, and this is again utilized by some other agency. For example, like the case of RBI, Reserve Bank of India, which is the central bank of our country, it publishes this data. This data are utilized by different institutions or different journals, all these things. So this data, when it is published, data from the original data, it is derived from some other sources. We call it as secondary data. So data is of two types. One is primary data, the other is secondary data. So data can be, primary data can be collected through different methods, like this direct personal observations, then indirect oral investigation, questionnaire sent by mail, schedule sent through investigators. So these are the way we can collect the primary data. So once the data is collected, then we utilize the data for statistical purposes. So while we will sample, we'll discuss a concept like population, census, or universe. So population or census or universe, all these are one term, that is the aggregate of data. Entire data is known as population, and from this data, if we select some data, we call it a sample. So it will go later on, we will discuss on the sampling sector. So aggregate of data or the total data in statistical sense, we call it as population or universe or census. Sample is a representative of that population. It depends on the size that we want. So then we have variables. Variables are the measurable characteristic which can be numerically expressed. It is numerically in terms of some unit. We call this as variable. So this variable may be a discrete variable, or we call it a discontinuous variable, or it may be a continuous variable. within certain range, we call it as continuous variable. So these variables or data we can express through frequency table, and this frequency table we can have tally marks, all these things which you will study from your book. Just I'm giving you what are the important things, tally marks, all these things. And what is important is we want to present this data in tabular form, then only we apply our statistics. So this once the data are collected, we can represent it through graphic representation also. So the graphic representations may be in the form of line diagram or graph. Then we have bar diagram. Then we have pie chart, all the histograms, all these things. But I will mainly explain the pie diagram. Pie diagram is a circular diagram. So as you know, a circle consists of 360 degrees. Suppose you have to represent marks of different subjects, like suppose say economist, statistics, then your macroeconomist, microeconomist, like this in the pie diagram. So we aggregate all the marks. Suppose the total marks that we get is 180. Suppose in statistics we get 60. 60 by 180 into 360, this will give you the degree of the pie diagram. Like this, we will collect all these degrees, then we find out the diagram, which we call it as pie diagram. So pie diagram is the circle diagram, which is one of the most important diagram in statistics. So pi consists of 360 degrees, as I have told you, 360 degrees. Thai. Ame manko charita subject ra economics or charita subject ra mark se pi diagram re represent kore ko chahuche. La ame sabu jako mark ta ko mishe dawa total marks manko hala 180. So 180 individual mark divided by 180 into 360. Se unje ame degree ta bahar kariba, degree, once we find out the degree, then we represent it in the pie diagram. So this is one of the important diagram which we call it as pie diagram. Then we come to your measures of location, which we call it as measures of central tendency. So measures of central tendency means a central value around which all other value revolves. Gote value baharibo ja sob represent thiba value sei ta hobo ta representative figure. A central value around which all other figures revolve, we call it as measures of central tendency or measures of location. So we have mainly three measures of location. One is mean, the other is median, the third one is mode. So popularly known as mean, median, mode. So here in mean, actually we mean arithmetic mean. But when we say mean in a broad sense, so there are three types of mean that comes across, that is in the book. One is arithmetic mean, which is represented as X bar. Then geometric mean, which is shortly written as GM, capital G dot M. And third is your harmonic mean. It is written as HM. So the most important mean is the arithmetic mean, which is universally used in different statistical analysis. So this arithmetic mean or harahari, which is in school level we call it as harahari or average. So the average is sum of the total values. Suppose I have four figures, namely 4, 5, 6, 8. So I add them 4 plus 5 plus 6 plus 8. चार पांच नौ नौ छः पंद्रह आठ तेईस. तो आई डिवाइड इट बाय नंबर ऑफ आइटम. 23 डिवाइडेड बाय 4 इज इक्वल टू 5.6, 5.7, 7 ना कैसे. सो दिस इज द एरिथमेटिक मीन ऑफ द फिगर. सो दिस अराउंड दिस फिगर ऑल अदर वैल्यू रिवॉल्व्स और रोटेट्स व्हाट वी कॉल. सो अगेन आई रिपीट, एरिथमेटिक मीन और पॉपुलरली नोन एज एवरेज, पॉपुलरली वी कॉल इट एज एवरेज, इज फाउंड आउट बाय सम ऑफ द आइटम्स नंबर्स डिवाइडेड बाय टोटल नंबर ऑफ आइटम्स. सो आई हैव टेकन द फोर. सो बिकॉज द फोर टोटल आई फाइंड आउट सम व्हिच कॉल इट ए समेशन एक्स आई. समेशन मीन्स टोटल डिवाइडेड बाय एन नंबर ऑफ ऑब्जर्वेशन और नंबर ऑफ आइटम्स. So this gives you, as I told you, is 5.75. So this is an individual series. A series consists of 1, 2, 3, 4 items. So series, when it is associated with frequency, so frequency is normally denoted as small f, that is the frequency. So this frequency, which you said that, suppose 3 appears 5 times, that is the frequency of 3. 5 times, that is f. This is x, this is f. So 4 appears, let us say 10 times. 10 is the frequency. 5 appears, let us say 15 times. So 15 is the frequency. 6 appears 20 times. So 20 is the frequency. So this variable 3, 4, 5, I call it as x variable. And the frequency, I write it as f. So I multiplied them. What I get is f multiply x, or popularly known as fx. So once I find out the fx of individual items, then I aggregate them. Summation fx I find out. So some x bar is equal to summation fx divided by summation f. That is total number of observations, with multiplied by the frequency and divided by total number of frequency, or we call it a summation f h capital N. So this is x bar is equal to summation f x by summation f. This is in case of discrete series. Also, this is true in case of your continuous series. In the continuous series, I mean 0 to 10, 10 to 20. 20 to 30, this is a continuous series. So the first that I have to, this is a discrete series, variable associated with frequency. Continuous series, we have a range. We call it as continuous series. And the frequency is there, we find out the middle item. So 0 to 10, middle value is 5. 10 to 20, middle value is 15. 20 to 30, middle value is 25. So like this, we find out the middle value, which we call it as x. And frequency is given. If we multiply them, we find out fxi divided by summation f, which we got, which call it x bar. So this is the arithmetic mean, which is generally used for statistical purposes. Geometric mean is the square root. Suppose x1 and x2. Two items are there. If we multiply them and find out the square root, this becomes the geometric mean of the series. So now comes to the median. So what is median? Median is the middlemost item of the series. It is the middlemost item of the series. If CB series is given, if we find out the middlemost item, we call it as median. Suppose we are given with a data like this. So the data is like this. So the data are given as, suppose they find 4, 3, 2, like this, a data is given. We find out the total number of observation. Then suppose this is n plus 1 divided by 2, whichever item which comes, this becomes the median of the series. So in case of median, when your in case frequency distribution is there, as I have told you, this frequency distribution, in case of frequency distribution, we find out the cumulative frequency. So what is the cumulative frequency? So it is like this. Just you observe, I am explaining you. Suppose two variable appears three times, three variable appears five times, four appears six times. So if I find out the cumulative frequency, addition of the succeeding frequency, three plus five plus six, cumulative frequency. Cumulative frequency, the addition of the succeeding frequency. Gote pore frequency mishe di gala, whatever we get is, suppose two to three times asthila. So frequency is three, cumulative frequency is three. Three appears five times, frequency is five. So it means your cumulative frequency is eight. Suppose four appears six times. So cumulative frequency of four is 8 plus 6, 14. So this is the cumulative frequency. We find out the cumulative frequency. Once we find out the cumulative frequency, and got a minute, assist. Once we find out the cumulative frequency, then n plus 1 by 2th item, we search for the cumulative frequency series, and there where it appears, that the corresponding value becomes the median of the value. Then comes the mode. So mode means the maximum number of times a value appears. That is the maximum number of frequency the value has. Suppose we have variable x, one appears two times, two appears two times, three appears three times, four appears two times, five appears two times, like this it is given. So we have to find out the modal value of the series. So to find out the modal value of the series, the maximum number three appears. So because the three has the maximum frequency, the mode value of the series is three. So again, repeat. The maximum frequency the value has, that will give you the modal value. Suppose in a series, it's given in frequency term, and suppose series is given, a particular item 62 appears 25 times, that is the highest number. So this 62 becomes the modal value of the series. So again, I repeat, modal value means the value whose frequency is the high, appearance of the frequency is the highest. It appears, or in other words, maximum number of times in the series. So if three appears eight times, all other items appears less than eight times, then modal value of the series becomes three. So it appears maximum number of time in the series, that will give you the modal value. So these three, mean, median, mode, they are known as measures of central tendency. So now we'll come to the measures of variation, which is also known as measures of dispersion, D-I-S-P-E-R-S-I-O-N. So what is this dispersion? Let us say there are two series, and these two series is the mark secured by student X and student Y. The average value of both the students are equal. Suppose the average value of the students are 45. This is the average value of both the students. But the distribution of marks is very skewed distribution, uneven distribution. It is like this. Suppose in mathematics, a student secures 80 marks. In English, she secures 30 marks. In political science, he secured, let us say, 35 marks. And in another subject, he secures 31 marks. For another student is there who has secured marks like this in a range like 45, 40, 42, 43, like this. So the even if the mean is same for X and Y, but the distribution of mark is better, the variation is less in case of student Y in comparison to student X. So another extreme example I gave you. Suppose there are three households. One household income is 999. Another household whose income is 100. And another household whose income is, let us say, 10. So the average mark of average income of the three household is 999 plus 100, 1099 plus 10, then you're divided by 3. Another data which I say that income is fairly distributed. It is like this, 500, 600, 700, like this it is distributed. So the variation is less as in case of student Y, also in the second case. So these variations are measured, which we call CTH, measures of dispersion. So the measures of dispersion are divided into two categories, absolute measures of dispersion and your relative measures of dispersion. So absolute measures of dispersion, we have got range, quartile deviation, mean deviation, and the most important is standard deviation. In the relative measures of dispersion, we have got coefficient of range, like coefficient of quartile deviation, coefficient of mean deviation, and coefficient of standard deviation. So I'm not going to discuss the detail because the most important is standard deviation. I concentrate on this. So standard deviation is generally denoted as a symbol which is small sigma. I'll show you when I come to the distribution part. So sigma itself is equal to x minus x bar, x minus x bar, summation x minus x bar whole square divided by n. So this will give you the standard deviation of this. So we take the deviation x minus x bar. After taking the x minus x bar deviation, we square them. After squaring them, then we find out the sigma. So sigma is equal to root over summation x minus x bar whole square divided by n. X minus x bar square divided by n root over. So this will give you the standard deviation. So this standard deviation is most important, like arithmetic mean. Standard deviation is most important in all the statistical analysis, which you'll see in course of time how mean and standard deviation are important. So first we calculate the mean for standard mean of this series. Then find the difference of each observation from mean, x minus x bar. Then square this x minus x bar square. And this square value to get the sum of this, add this to get the sum of the square. Divide by the number of observation, n. Then find out the square root. This will give you the standard deviation. So this square of the standard deviation, we call it as variance. Sigma square, we call it as variance. So another important thing in this standard deviation is the coefficient of variation. So what is this coefficient of variation? Coefficient of variation is sigma divided by x bar into 100. So this coefficient of variation is a relative measure which will find out the the consistency of any particular income or any score or anything. So this is coefficient of variation. So this mean and standard deviation, that is the measures of central tendency and the measures of dispersion. Another two concept crops up. They are skewness and kurtosis. So this skewness measures the degree of asymmetry in a data. So what is this degree of asymmetry? So I have told you that symmetry is a situation where mean, median, mode coincide, or mean is equal to median is equal to mode. This we call it a symmetric distribution. If there is difference in all these things, there is difference between mean, median and mode, we call it as asymmetric distribution. So this asymmetric distribution may be a positively skewed distribution or a negatively skewed distribution. Applying this arithmetic mean and your standard deviation, we can find out this skewness of the distribution. So like this, beta 2 measures the shape of the curve. So there is moment, I am not going to discuss that. So the skewness and kurtosis are the other very distribution which is important after this measures of central tendency and measures of distribution. So now we will go to the theoretical distributions, or which we call a probability distribution. So we will discuss mainly three theoretical distribution. So I'm not going to the mathematical part of that. So one is your binomial distribution, the other is your Poisson distribution, and third one is your normal distribution. So I will give this in a PowerPoint presentation. Ashish, PowerPoint dekha jau ji? Hello? Hello?
PowerPoint
ta dekha jau ji?
Nahi, apana share karantu.
हाँ, शेयर करछि
प्रेजेंट नाउ अछि सेतरे जाय कि ब्राउज करि कि सेटा को शेयर करो
शेयर
प्रेजेंट नाउ सर तळो को जदि आपण नै जिबे एरो टा को अवसर टा को जदि मते प्रेजेंट नाउ आछ
अच्छा को जगह ऐसे वास्ते था क्या
सर एरोटा को जो तड़ो को नहीं जीवे पसंद था
हाँ हाँ तड़ो था
हाँ इधर लास्ट तीन ही डॉट अच्छी तापा कर प्रेजेंट नाउ बनी को टच
हाँ देख लिया बाजू
में एरोटा अच्छी इधर कुछ जाए कि
हाँ तापोरे
ये विंडो करो अगर उसे इकाल एटा को रखी चलते तो बोल
हाँ हाँ विंडो करी विंडो टॉप सेल हेला
अच्छा सर
अच्छा
ना आ गोटे विंडो आछि कि बस एटी
असला
नो सर असला तो फुल स्क्रीन कर दे
फुल स्क्रीन
जैसे पावर पॉइंट तळे पूरा गोटे अछि मग भलिया गोटे तळे कमेंट लिखा है कि तारो तीनी टा आइकन छोड़ी चार नंबर आइकन टा
कमेंट चारिता ये अछि
कमेंट्स तापर दीटा तीनी टा छाड़ी दियो तो चार नंबर टा नहीं तापर टा सर जोटा कले तापर टा गोटे क्लास भले अछि
नहीं तो हला हां हला बे
हां
So I will first go to the problem distribution, that is the binomial distribution.
Control minus from the basic body gala.
Basic body gala. Body gala. See. अच्छा हां
देखो बेटा देखा जाउ छी तपरे
कौन हैला
हां सर
हबो ना कौन करे ऊपर
ठीक अछि परम
हैला
हां सर
So first one is binomial distribution. So binomial distribution is a discrete probability distribution. There are two parameters of binomial distribution. One is small p, the other is q. So p stands for probability of success, and q stands for probability of failure. P plus Q is equal to 1. If P is equal to 1 by 3, the Q is automatically 1 minus 1 by 3 is equal to 2 by 3. So N is the number of trial and it is finite. So mean of the, if we find out the mean of the binomial distributions, it will be NP, small n multiplied by P. And variance of the, if I find out, it is NPQ. So variance is the square of the standard deviation. So with the help of this variance or from this variance, we can find out the standard deviation. That is square of the variance, that is root over of NPQ. That is root over of one root over of variance will give you the standard deviation. So each discrete distribution has a probability distribution, which we call it a probability density function. So it is the probability density function written as PR because I have taken this R, or you can take it as X. So this is equal to NCR. PR q to the power n minus r. NCR here, p implies here as usual your probability of success, q probability of failure, n is the number of observations which is finite, and r is the whatever you take, 1, 2, 3, 4, like this. So c stands for a combination. So this combination which is say, is from algebraic distributions, your permutation and combination. So here there is a concept called factorial. So if I say factorial 3 means 3 into 2 into 1. If I say factorial 8, 7, 6, 5, 4, 3, 2, 1, up to like this. So the concept of factorial is used here. So this distribution is generally applicable in case of Bernoulli trials, all these things, what we call it as your Bernoulli distribution. From this Bernoulli distributions, we can find out the Poisson distribution. So Poisson distribution, the name of St. Poisson, name of a person, statistician. So this is equal to the probability density function is given as e to the power minus m. This m is a parameter, which is a constant. M to the power x. So here in the first figure, I have taken it as r, but here I take it as x. You can take it as r or x. Probability density of functions are given as e to the power minus m, m to the power x, factorial x. So I have given this symbol, either this or x, this symbol represents your factorial. So this e value is equal to 2.7183. It is the estimated value, earlier estimated. So x variable, it is wrongly written as n, 0, 1, 2, 3 up to infinity. It is not n, this is infinity. So m is finite, positive constant known as parameters. So here is a distribution whose mean and variance are equal. That is, mean is m and variance is also m. So this Poisson distribution is a limiting case of binomial distribution when n is finitely large, tends to infinity, and the mean np is equal to m. So the most important distribution that we will discuss is your normal distribution. So, like your mean and standard deviation, normal distribution is also one of the important distribution in statistical analysis, which is, as we can say, that almost universally applicable. It is also known as a Gaussian distribution. So here it is a continuous, it is not a discrete distribution, it is a continuous distribution. X is a continuous random variable following normal distribution with mean X bar. We say that X is a variable, continuous variable, whose mean is X bar and standard deviation is sigma. So the very beginning when I told the standard deviation, this symbol is known as standard deviation small sigma, because the summation sign, the capital summation sign is also there, which is also known as sigma. So this is small. So probability density function is given by 1 divided by 2 pi, then multiplied sigma. 2 pi is root over, not sigma. Then e to the power minus half within bracket x minus x bar divided by sigma whole square, where x lies between minus infinity to plus infinity. So again, I am repeating. If x is a continuous random variable with mean x bar or mu and standard deviation sigma, the probability density function is given by 1 by 2 pi root over in the denominator multiplied sigma e to the power minus half within bracket x minus x bar sigma whole square, where x lies between minus infinity to plus infinity. And this mean and standard deviation are called parameters. So now we'll define another concept, that is a standard normal variate or standardized variate. Standard normal variate or standardized. So what is this standard normal variate or standardized variate? So I define capital Z is equal to x minus x bar by sigma. So this Z is the standard normal variate, whose mean is 0 and standard deviation is 1. So because the probability density function of the normal distribution is a very big one, and this is very difficult to calculate. So most of the things are calculated with the help of standard normal variate with mean 0 and standard deviation 1. So this is also at times known as standardized variate. So one of the important thing of the normal distribution is the normal probability curve, which one who is reading statistics has to know this normal curve, which is popularly called, that is area under the normal curve. So this area, this is the middle point, x is equal to mu, this is the middle point. At this middle point, the curve is equally divided into two parts, 0.5, 0.5. The total area is 1. 0.5, 0.5, the total area is 1. So, if I take the x, I have taken standard normal variate also taken, and also usual mu and standard deviation. So if this area x lies between mu plus standard deviation and mu minus standard deviation, what is the area that it covers? It covers the total probability curve is 1. It covers 68.26% of the area. Again, I repeat. If x lies between mu plus 1 standard deviation and mu minus 1 standard deviation, it covers 68.26 area of the normal curve. If it is 2 standard deviation, it covers 95.44% area of the normal. Dekha jauchi Ashish? Hello? So, one standard deviation plus minus one standard deviation covers 68.26 area. Two standard deviation plus minus it covers 95.44% area, and three standard deviation it covers 99.73 area. So if I take it in probability terms, it is 0.6826 in second one, 0.9544, third one, 0.9973. So this is in terms of the probability distribution when it is a your probability density function. So when it is standard normal variate, which is usually utilized when you find out this area under the normal curve. So here this mean is 0. So I said that standard normal variate Z is mean 0 and your standard deviation is 1. So minus 1 plus 1, it covers 68.26 area. Minus 2 plus 2, it covers 95.44% area. And minus 3 plus 3, it covers 99.73 area. So I have indicated them in your arrow line. It is there in your book prominently exhibited. This thing is prominent. So this is most important thing. Normal probability curve, or which is popularly called a normal curve. This is a symmetric curve where mean, median, mode coincide in that curve. This is a symmetric curve. where there is lack of skewness. There is no skewness in this. Skewness is zero. So this is about area under the probability density function. So you must do that. Characteristics of normal distribution, and under the characteristic, this is one of the fundamental thing that we have to discuss, the probability under the normal curve. So now we'll go to the book, your block 2, which we call it as sampling theory, or your first we'll go to sampling theory, then we'll go to sampling distribution. So what is this sampling? Oh, that's right. So now we'll go to the sampling theory. So before going to the sampling theory, just I've introduced the concept population or universe or census. So it implies aggregate of objects, that is the population. Suppose you are reading in Open University. So all the students of the Open University, they constitute a universe or a population or a census. The students who are reading economics, they constitute a sample. So population means aggregate of objects. Anything, suppose you are living in a village. For census purposes, your village is your population, or that is your universe, or this is your census. Or if you are from a gram panchayat, you can take gram panchayat as a universe or block as a universe, like this. It means aggregate of objects. So it may be a finite population or infinite population. So if we count them, then we call it as finite. If we cannot count them, for example, stars in the sky, as we say, it cannot be counted. So we call them as infinite population. So population, as you generally mean, it is a case of census. For every 10 years, the government of India had so here the population is total objects. So I can say, for example, we are living in a district. You can call this district as your population or a census, depending on this, your what you want to find out. So from this population, we can find out a sample. So this sample is a representative of that population. So how it is representative of the population? Suppose you are living in a district, let us say Borgarh. You want to calculate the Borgarh per capita income of the people of Borgarh district. So this is your universe. So you do not have enough fund, or you do not have enough time to calculate the per capita income going from one door to another door, or from, it is not possible on your part to take all the data. So you have to find out the representative data, which we call it a sample. So with the help of the sample, we can find out the per capita income, which will be a representative of the population. So sample is a representative of the population. So this sample has certain advantage. So there is less of cost is involved in that sample selection. Better scope for information. So when you take all the data, then your information may be biased information. Some may not go from door to door and collect the data. So, but we have better scope of information in case of the sample data. There is also better quality data, because we choose a particular level, so quality of data may be assured, and gives us gives an idea of error. Amar kete by error rahuchi, it gives an idea of that. So if in, there is a cost increase when we increase the sample size. So what I mean to say, population is aggregate of objects and sample is a representative of the population. And we know that from the sample theory, which we'll go to later on, the population has parameters and sample has statistics. The parameters of the populations are mean and variance, and sample statistic is mean and variance also, or standard deviation. So theory says the sample mean is an unbiased estimate of population mean, and sample variance, there is a relationship in between that. When I will come to that, I will discuss that. So because it is a representative of the population, that is why the sample is chosen. So there are different types of sample. And the most important sample that we select is simple random sampling, or popularly known as a random sampling. Suppose we want to find out from the universe a data we want to find out, a particular thing we want to find out. So it is not possible to search for every village to find out the data. So we find out a sample that we will, from each panchayat, we will take 2 to 3 samples. Then we will find out the data. So this is done in a random manner. So we cannot prefer X to Y. Whatever it comes in a lottery method, suppose we have 100, population size is 100. Out of the population size of 100, we want to find out our sample size is 10. So through lottery method, we assign number to the 100 population, and then at randomly we select some samples. That is 10 numbers we randomly selected. So each and every item has equal chance of being selected. We cannot say that 1 to 10 will come and 99 to 100. Every item of the population has a chance to be selected. So that is why we call it a random sample. So this can we do it with replacement or without replacement. Suppose, what is this with replacement? Suppose my population or census consists of 3 items. There are 3 objects, namely 1, 2, 3. These are the 3 numbers I have got. So from this, I have to select a sample size of 2. My sample size is 2 and population size is 3. So first I will take with replacement. So sample size is 1. So there is possibility that 1 may come. That is the sample size. 1, 2 may come. 1, 3 may come. So like this, I can find out from each 1, 1, 1, 2, 1, 3, 2, 2, 2, 1, 2, 3, 3, 3, 3, 1, 3, 2. Like this, I can find out 3 samples, 9 samples out of this 3. Again, I repeat. I am finding out 9 samples out of population size of 3 and sample size of 2 when there is with replacement. I draw 1, I replace it. This is what the with replacement implies. So this sample which I have found out, if I find out the mean of this means of the mean of the sample, it will be equal to the population mean. So what is the population mean? Population mean is 3, 2 plus 1. So 6 divided by 3 is equal to 2. If we find out means of the sample mean, it is also equal to 2. So that is why sample mean is an unbiased estimate of population mean. Second, without replacement. With replacement, without replacement. So I again the 3 samples. I draw 1. So what is the possibility of getting a sample? I can get 1, 2. I can get 1, 3. So like this, I can get in the second split 2, 1, 2, 3. 3, 1, 3, 2. So I'm here, I'm getting 6 samples. Hello? So I'm getting, without replacement, I'm getting 6 samples. But with replacement, I'm getting 9 samples. So in the with replacement case, we said that if it is n, n is the population size, and r is the sample size, n to the power r. So in my case, 3 to the power 2, it becomes 9. And in the other case, this is equal to n into n minus 1. 3 multiplied n minus 1 is 2 is equal to 6. So in both the cases, sample median unbiased estimate of population mean. So if you find out the sample mean, this becomes the population mean. That is why it is representative of the population mean. So then comes another sample, which we call it a stratified sample. So what is this stratified sample? So we divide the population into different strata, different categories. Suppose you want to find out the income of Sambalpur town, per capita income of Sambalpur town. So the let us say our sample size is 50. We select out of this 3 lakhs population, we take the sample size of 50. So there is the possibility that an enumerator, one who collects data, we call it him or her as an enumerator. There is possibility that the enumerator may go to one place, which is the Basti area, and find and take 50 data, and we will say that this is the per capita income of Sambalpur town. That is the possibility. So in case of stratified sampling, we divide the population city into different strata, different groups. Area where rich people live, area where middle class people live, area where low middle class people live, area where poor people live. So we take the data from these 4 categories, then find out the per capita income. So this is a more representative in comparison to simple random sample. We call it a stratified random sampling. So another sample is there, which we call it as purposive sample, for a particular purpose. Suppose we want to know in a particular area, what is the impact of fertilizer on your cauliflower crop or cabbage crop. So for this purpose in mind, we find out the sample and find out the value of it. We call it a purposive sampling. Then we have cluster sampling. So what is this cluster sampling? Cluster means we divide a particular area in different units. Suppose we want to find out the yield of crops in Western Orissa per acre. So we divide into different clusters. Bargarh area one cluster, Sambalpur area one cluster, Balangir one cluster, Kalahandi one cluster, like this. From this cluster, we collect the data. Once the data is collected, then we find out the yield of crop per acre. Another is two-stage sampling. So what is this two-stage sampling? So in Orissa, there are 30 districts and there are subdivisions and there are blocks. Suppose a particular data, government wants a particular data from the block level. So from the district level to block level, but subdivision level, from subdivision level to block level. So there are 2 stages. Subdivision level, from subdivision to district level. So because it involves 2 stages, we call it as two-stage sampling. Suppose it extended to panchayat level, it extended to ward level of the village. We call it as multi-stage sampling. Then we have another sample, which is called it a systematic sampling. So what is this systematic sampling? So these are generally used when we want to count the number of trees in a particular forest. We start a point that the 10th number is the starting point. From 10th number onwards, from each 10th, 20th number, we put another. From 30th number, another. Like this, we put the symbol. So this is a systematic sample. In a systematic way, that is, the difference is 10 units. It is a systematic sampling. Systematic way it is being collected. So this sample has certain advantage over your population. So population involves a lot of money. So it is less cost, sample is less costly. Like this, it is there. So what we have is that population and sample. Sample is a representative of the population, and this representative of the population, if we do not have enough fund, enough time, and enough energy, and enough all these things, then we can go for sample, and sample is a representative of the population. So then comes your what you most important chapter is your statistical inference. So the objective of the sample is to study the feature of the population, the basis of sample observation. This is most important. The objective of the sample is to study the feature of the population. So because we can study the feature of the population, that is why we can rely on sample. We can infer about the population from the statistical analysis of the sample. This process is known as sample inference. So what is that? We shall infer about the population from the statistical analysis of sample. This process is known as sample inference. So here there are two problems are there. One is problem of estimation, and second problem is testing hypothesis. So in the first case, no information about the population is available, population characteristics is available. So we call it as problem of estimation. And second is in the inference, you have the testing of hypothesis. Hypothetical values of the parameters is taken. So in the theory of estimation, we have two methods. One is point method, and the other is interval estimation. So the good characteristics of estimators are unbiasedness, consistency, and efficiency. These are the two important characteristics: consistency, unbiasedness, and efficiency. Also, another characteristic is there in some book, it is a sufficiency. So what is this unbiasedness? So the unbiasedness implies an estimate that sample sample mean sample mean and population mean means difference is zero, or sample mean is an unbiased estimate of population mean. So if I find out the expectation of x bar and I find minus it from the actual mean, this is equal to, there is no bias. That is what is called unbiasedness. There is no bias in the estimation. That is, expected value of x bar or the estimated value of x bar minus the actual mean, what the actual mean is equal to zero. That is, sample mean is an unbiased estimate of population mean. Sample means minus population mean is equal to zero. So consistency implies that we increase the sample size, it leads very close to the population size, a population mean. If we increase the sample size, the sample mean is very close to the population mean. This we call it as consistency. Efficiency implies if we compare two estimators, so estimator X and estimator Y, if the variance of estimator X is less than the variance of estimator Y, then X is a efficient estimator. An estimator is said to be sufficient if it contains all the information in the sample regarding parameters. Again, I repeat. A estimator is said to be sufficient if it contains all the information in the sample regarding the parameters. Parameters, two parameters I have told you, that mean and standard deviation. So the sample contains all the information about the population parameter. If it is there, then we call it as your sufficiency. So four characteristics I have told you: unbiasedness, consistency, efficiency, and sufficiency. These are the ideal characteristic of a good estimator. So next important thing is the test of significance. That is what I have told, that from the hypothetical figure we draw the conclusion. Hypothetical values of the parameters or the population parameters means population parameter. So the study of the test of significance is based on the sample results. That the sampling results, it is based on this. So first is that we study the deviation between observed sample statistics and hypothetical population parameters. Two things: observed sample statistics. Sample statistics, mean and standard deviation, or mean and variance. Observed, which is already observed sample mean, and the hypothetical parameters. Hypothetical, we assume it's a certain values of population. That is the hypothetical parameters. That is the first one. Second one, this deviation between two independent sample statistics is significant or might be attributed to chance or to the fluctuation in the sample. So the first one is most important, that is hypothetical population figure and observed sample data, test of significance. So here we have two types of sample. One is large sample, the other is small sample. So when the sample, generally sample is denoted, number is denoted in terms of small n, and capital N is for population or census. When the small n or the sample size is less than 30, we call it a small sample. When the sample size is greater than 30, we call it a large sample. So to test this, we establish two hypotheses. One is null hypothesis. I'll tell you how it is written, capital H subscript 0. And the other one is alternate hypothesis, capital H subscript 1 or capital H subscript A. This is alternate hypothesis. So this null hypothesis and alternate hypothesis concept is given by R.A. Fisher, a statistician, with which we test for possible rejection under the assumption that it is true. That will come to later. No? So we have two theses. One is hypothesis, one is null hypothesis. The second one is alternate hypothesis. Suppose we proceed like this. So null hypothesis, we say that the population mean is equal to mu 0, that is mu is equal to mu zero. So this is the null hypothesis, that we assume that hypothetical figure mu is equal to mu zero. So alternate hypothesis that we establish is mu is not equal to mu zero. So this means mu may be greater than zero or mu may be less than zero. So if this is the case, we call it a two-tailed test, alternate hypothesis. If it is greater than zero, we call it a right-tailed alternative. If it is less than zero, mu zero, we call it a left-tailed alternative. So two-tailed test and one-tailed test. Now I will give a concept called your type 1 error and type 2 error. In a PowerPoint, I will present you what is this type 1 error and type 2 error. Yep. Ashish, dekha jauchi?
Yes, sir. This is type 1 and type 2 error.
So the two errors, one is type 1 error, the other is type 2 error. So I have two hypotheses. One is null hypothesis, the other is alternate hypothesis. So it is wrongly written in the. I am just explaining you. It is null hypothesis at zero. Hello? Subscript I have zero ta tolku asio eta eka sange rahi jaichi h0 and r ta bhi hela null hypothesis h0 eta hela accept null hypothesis reject null hypothesis again I am repeating h o nai h ra subscript rahibo eta null hypothesis h tole ta like ki rahibo subscript zero that is null hypothesis true null hypothesis false null hypothesis accept, null hypothesis reject. If null hypothesis is true, we accept it, it is a correct decision. If null hypothesis is true, but we reject it, we call it as type 1 error. If null hypothesis is false, we accept it, type 2 error is occurring. If null hypothesis is false, we reject it, correct decision is there. Well, again, I repeat, true null hypothesis, accept the null hypothesis, correct decision. True null hypothesis, reject the null hypothesis, type 1 error. True false null hypothesis, accept type 2 error. And this is correct. So this is most important, type 1 error and type 2 error, which is we committed. So we committed this type 1 error and type 2 error, which is a part of this issue. So one tail test, two tail test, then your type 1 error and type 2 error. So what is another concept is there? What is a critical region? The critical region is the region of values that corresponding to the rejection of null hypothesis at some chosen probability level. So chosen probability level is generally at the level of significance, either at 5% or 1%. So this is the critical value. Rejection region is the critical value. The complementary to the rejection region, we call it as acceptance region. This we call it as acceptance region. So the level of significance is always fixed in advance before collecting the sample information. The level of significance employed in testing of hypothesis are normally 5% and 1% level of significance. Level of significance is also known as the size of the type 1 error. So when we define a data, we do it some procedure of significance testing, that is statement of the problem we take, then we define the hypothesis, then we test it at 5% or 1% level of significance. So in the small sample test, we have t-test and f-test like this. And this test, we find out having this, your level of significance, all these things. Ase seti kahiba au chi square kahiba ni beshi difficult hi jio na koi chi
square
ta ki koi debe koi jo seta to easy tarike sir chi square So one is concept which is standard error. Standard error of mean is the standard deviation divided by n, root n. And standard error of standard deviation is standard deviation divided by 2n root over. So one of the test, important test, is your chi-square test. So this test is performed for your consistency test, for all these things it is performed. So the simplest way of finding out the chi-square, I have found out given that formula. Observed frequency minus expected frequency, that is for frequency which is calculated, we call it as expected frequency. Observed frequency minus expected frequency square, bracket, whole square, divided by E. So one column is observed frequency, another column is expected frequency. And with this observed frequency and expected frequency, we have two columns are there. We find out O minus E, then square them, then divide by E, then find out this summation. Finding out the summation, this becomes the chi-square calculated value. So once the chi-square calculated value is found out, then we find out this chi-square tabulated value with the help of degree of freedom. So here the degree of freedom here means number of frequencies minus one. This is another way of representing this. This is a column minus row. This is not there here. Formula is not there. So n minus one. So at n minus one degree of freedom, we find out the tabulated value of chi-square. Then we compare the tabulated value of chi-square with the calculated value of chi-square. Then we draw the conclusion basing on our null hypothesis. If it's greater, then we accept it. If it's less, we reject. So this is what is about your chi-square test. So like this, another test which is little bit easier is your F test. Capital F test. It is not there in my PowerPoint. So this is equal to variance of series 1 divided by the variance of series 2. Two series are there. We find out the variance of this series. So this variance, which is higher variance, this will be in the numerator, and the smaller variance will be in the denominator. And then we find out the ratio, F ratio. This will be the table calculated value of F. Then we find out the tabulated value of F with the help of degree of freedom. So degree of freedom in the first case, in the first row, n minus 1, in the second also n minus 1. So two values, first variance degree of freedom and second variance degree of freedom. then we find out the tabulated value of f, then compare the tabulated value of f with the calculated value of f basing on the null hypothesis and the alternate hypothesis, we accordingly draw the conclusion. Hello? Hello?
Yes, sir. So, learners, if you have any doubts, you may raise the questions now. Please use the chat box. In today's session, we discussed these measures of central tendency, mean, median, mode. We also discussed measures of dispersion, specifically standard deviation and variance. Subsequently, we also discussed skewness hypothesis and then the distribution, both symmetric and asymmetric distributions, probability distribution, normal distributions, Poisson distributions, and binomial distributions. We also discussed the various types of sampling like stratified random sampling, then cluster sampling, multi-stage sampling, so purposive sampling. Then we also discussed the statistical inference, both point and interval estimation. We also discussed several properties such as consistency, unbiasedness, and efficiency and sufficiency that a good estimator must have. So, further, we also discussed about this standard error and the hypothesis testing, null hypothesis, and the alternative hypothesis, and what hypothesis, how it can be rejected, or when it should reject. All these concepts we have discussed in today's session. So if you have any, okay, there is one doubt here, type 1 and type 2 error. The distinction between type 1 error and type 2 error. One question has come, sir. You can also raise if you have some more doubts, so that we will take one by one. Type 1 and type 2 error.
In hypothesis testing, two kinds of error may take place. One is type 1 error and the other is type 2 error. Type 1 error means rejecting the hypothesis when it is true. When it is true, we are rejecting the hypothesis. We call this as type 1 error. Whereas type 2 error means accepting the hypothesis when it is false. So that is diametrically. When it is true, we are rejecting the hypothesis. Null hypothesis we are having. And when it is true, we are rejecting it. We call it as type 1 error. And when it is false, we are accepting it. We call it as type 2 error. হেলা না বুঝে হেলা না গোটে হাইপোথিসিস অছি সেই হাইপোথিসিস রে আমি সববেলে যেতে করুছি আমার টেবুলেটেড ভ্যালু আর গোটে ক্যালকুলেটেড ভ্যালু থাকে ক্যালকুলেটেড ভ্যালুটা আমি নিজ বাহারে করু টেবুলেটেড ভ্যালুটা আমার স্ট্যাটিস্টিক্স বহির পছরে থাকে সেটা অলরেডি এস্টিমে ক্যালকুলেটেড আর্লিয়র আমি তাকে কৌছু টেবুলেটেড ভ্যালু আমি মনে কর নৌছে গোটে এফ টেস্ট নৌছে সেটা গোটে ভেরিয়েন্স টেস্ট করছে সেই ভেরিয়েন্স টেস্টে আমি গোটে হাইপোথিসিস নেইছে আমি জানুছি যে সে হাইপোথিসিসটা ট্রু কিন্তু আমি সে হাইপোথিসিসটাকে মনা কর রিজেক্ট করে দেছে আমি যেটা মনা করে দেছে যদি সেটা রিজেক্ট করে দেছে আমি সেইটি টাইপ 1 এরর কমিট করছে जदि आम जानूचु ये ठीक अच्छी किंतु स्टिल आम कहू नो इट इज नॉट एक्सेप्टेबल वी रिजेक्टेड इट हला मन कर वर्तमान तुमर जमीती गोटे जिनस मन कर पंगपाल बर्तमान आस पंगपाल गोटे मेडिसिन इफेक्टिव हो आम जानूचे से मेडिसिन टा इफेक्टिव हो हाइपोथेसिस कहे ये ट्रु किंतु आम कहे ना से ट्रु नुह आम ये कर पंगपाल मरवे नहीं कहे से टाइप टू टाइप वन मेजरमेंट अच्छी बीटा टू थ्रू रे मेजर करा जाए बीटा टू जो इज इक्वल टू थ्री है मेसोकॉर्टिक कहो जदि बीटा टू लेस देन थ्री है प्लाटिकोर्टिक कहो जो ग्रेटर देन थ्री है लेप्टोक्रोटिक कहो गोटे लेफ्ट साइड को जी गोटे प्लाटिपस जमती से देखा से कहे प्लाटिपस इट मेजर्स द शेप ऑफ द कर्व बीटा टू मेजरमेंट से कहे कटोसिस मान कटोसिस मान है मेजर टा है बीटा टू कटोसिस माने हला इट इज द शेप ऑफ द कर्व दैट वी कॉल इट एज कटोसिस हाउ व्हाट इट लुक्स लाइक दैट वी कॉल इट एज कटोसिस मतलब किसी देखा को नहीं देखा थे देखे दे था प्लाटिकोर्टिक
बेसिकली द डिग्री ऑफ पिकनेस
हां पिकनेस
डिग्री ऑफ पिकनेस ऑफ ए डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन ऑफ ए पॉइंट
करेक्ट कर्व रो तो डिस्ट्रीब्यूशन ऊपर तो जानिबे नहीं गोटे कर्व रो प्लाटिकोटिक कौन कहले बुझे पावर ऑफ द टेस्ट तो मुझे देखने से तो मैं जान चुकी बुझे दियो मुझे तो देखी नहीं जान जो
अगर
कोई हो देखने में पावर ऑफ तेरा ऐसे पौन तो मुझे आई नहीं थी तो देखने से
आपको एनी अदर डाउट लेवल ऑफ सिग्निफिकेंस
हाँ लेवल ऑफ सिग्निफिकेंस तो This is one of the important thing in testing of hypothesis. The maximum probability with which a true null hypothesis is rejected is known as level of significance. Again, I repeat. A true null hypothesis rejection of 5% and 1% achieve. The maximum probability with which a true null hypothesis rejected. That is again a type 1 error. True null hypothesis is rejected. The maximum probability, it may be 5%, it may be 1% level of significance. The maximum probability with which a true null hypothesis is rejected. True null hypothesis, I mean reject koruche. That is the type one error that we committing. That where type one error occurring, say ye taku paaje level of significance. 5% hai pare, 1% hai pare. Seta se tamo tamo jo normal curve hoche, se normal curve ra one jodi right left tail right tail test hela normal curve di bhag hai gela. Gota hela. लेफ्ट साइड 0.5 राइट साइड 0.5 और 50% 50% सेपटे 1% नेले केते हबो आउ 5% नेले केते हबो से ओनली तम लेवल ऑफ सिग्नल से डिटरमिन हो से कर्व रा से पोर्शन ता
डेवलप देन purpose of hypothesis testing. Before that, they have asked about this power of a test. That is the probability of rejecting the null hypothesis when it is false. What is the probability that we are rejecting the null hypothesis when it is false? What do you mean by rejecting the null hypothesis when it is false? That is the probability of that is known as the power of the test, power of the hypothesis. The probability of rejecting the null hypothesis when it is false.
Probability of rejecting the null hypothesis when it is false.
The probability of rejecting the null hypothesis when it is false is the power of the hypothesis.
Achha. False it when you are rejecting it.
What is that probability? False it was, kintu we are rejecting it. We are rejecting it.
See, probability ta hochi power of a test.
तपरे purpose of hypothesis testing.
Purpose of hypothesis testing. So it depends on different hypothesis which you are testing. Suppose you are testing either a particular medicine, your particular pesticide is accepted for your different types of your different कौन से उड़ा creatures जोड़ा का तो पोको सब आस्तुन्दी different pests आस्तुन्दी से pest मान को पाएं तो हम pesticide टा applicable हो जोड़ा applicable को उच्चा से टा acceptable की नहीं हमें hypothesis testing को से टा जानिवा मन कर बर्तमान गोटे वर्ल्ड ओवर गोटे जिनस चली इंडिया रे सेटा हला गोटे स्टैटिस्टिकल मॉडल दिया हैतला कोरोना वायरस पे गोटे ग्रुप ऑफ लोक देथले गोटे स्टैटिस्टिकल मॉडल से मॉडल बेसिस रे इंडिया रे लॉकडाउन हला तो व्हाट इज द पर्पस ऑफ द मॉडल पर्पस ऑफ द मॉडल इज टू सी दैट कोरोना वायरस विल नॉट स्प्रेड इन इंडिया किंतु दैट मॉडल फेल्ड गोटे ग्रुप ऑफ साइंटिस्ट स्टैटिस्टिशियन मिसिकी से गोटे मॉडल देते से मॉडल से इंडिया जब एतिक दिन लॉकडाउन है कोरोना वायरस इंडिया पड़ेब तो व्हाट इज द पर्पस ऑफ दिस हाइपोथेसिस द पर्पस ऑफ दिस हाइपोथेसिस इज दैट कोरोना वायरस विल नॉट बी देयर इफ दिस मॉडल इज देयर सो दिस मॉडल इज नाउ रिजेक्टेड है ना बुझी हलानी हेलो
यस सर
आ कौन है
काई स्क्वायर टेस्ट
हैला जे हमको काई स्क्वायर रे डिफरेंट फार्मूला आछि मतलब तो इजीएस्ट फार्मूला देथि गोटे एसोसिएशन टेस्ट अछि सेटा प्रत्येक गोटे गोटे स्क्वायर रे गोटे गोटे डाटा थाए
Observed frequency and expected frequency difference of square divided by the expected frequency. That means sum करिवा सब observation.
Observed then, frequency minus our expected frequency काढ़िवा आगो expected frequency काढ़िवा तापरे ता deviation काढ़िवा आगोटे column रे O minus E ताकु square करिवा next column रे नेक्स्ट कॉलम रे से स्क्वायर को डिवाइडेड बाय द ऑब्जर्व फ्रीक्वेंसी करिवा तापरे तारो टोटल समेशन बाहर करिया दैट विल गिव द काई स्क्वायर कैलकुलेटेड वैल्यू से कैलकुलेटेड वैल्यू को विल कंपेयर विथ काई स्क्वायर टेबुलेटेड वैल्यू अकॉर्डिंगली हाइपोथेसिस हम एक्सेप्ट करिवा कि रिजेक्ट करिवा दैट विल गिव यू द आईडिया
केबर राव इनइक्वालिटी
मेरा तो मैथमेटिकल पूरा है कम बुझ
मैथमेटिकल नीड्स सम डेरिवेशन केमर सर
ସେଇଟା କିଛି ବୁଝିପାରିବେନି, ସେଇଟା ଖାଲି ଜାଣିବା କଥା, ଖାଲି ନାଁଟା ଶୁଣିଥିବା କଥା, କିଛି ବୁଝି ହେବନି।
बहुत ही सम काइंड ऑफ मैथमेटिकल डेरिवेशन सो विल टेक इट मे बी सेपरेटली। सो इफ देयर इज नो अदर क्वेश्चंस थैंक यू सर फॉर दिस वंडरफुल सेशन। आई एम श्योर मेनी क्वेश्चंस केम सो स्टूडेंट्स वेर अटेंटिव दे वेर दे आस्क्ड लॉट ऑफ क्वेश्चंस दिस टाइम एंड देन दे आर इंटरेक्टिंग। आई एम श्योर दे वुड हैव गॉट बेनिफिटेड at least this would be very useful from them from the exam point of view in writing the conceptual things. With this we will formally close this session. Thank you again sir.
Thank you sir.
Yes.